Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Thucydides Trap by Melinda M. Snodgrass, narrated by Nicole Poole. 1. Fears and Fury. Mercedes Adelina Saturnina Inez de Arango, Empress of the Solar League and First Star Lord of the Estrella de Orden, should have been feeling well satisfied with the current state of the galaxy. She had just led her military to a massive and stunning victory over an alien threat that had killed and injured several million of her citizens and resulted in billions of dollars of damage to the infrastructure on 5 worlds. She should have been reunited with her child, back on the capital world and beginning to rebuild the palace and the League, but instead, she was on hellfire because Admiral Marquez Ernesto Chapman Owiti, head of the military's R&D division, had requested an urgent meeting. The planet held the bulk of the Solar League's military command structure, and the couple currently inhabited a secure conference room deep in the bowels of the Ministerio de Guerra, known more colloquially as the Octagon. She and Ernesto had been classmates at the Imperial Military Academy, and Ernesto had always been the personification of cool. So when his message had contained words like urgent and critically important, Mercedes changed her plans and taken her dreadnought straight to Hellfire rather than home to Oranos. Mercedes studied the threads of gray that were now woven through Chapman Owiti's dark curls and reflected that it had been a damn long time since they had all been in school together. Of course, the same silver wove through her hair as well. Inwardly, she might still feel like that 18-year-old who had gone off to military school in order to win a throne. But the truth was etched in the lines on her face, the gray in her hair, and the ache in her bones. Ernesto usually had a blazing smile, but not today. Today, his expression was both grim and exhausted. She braced herself for terrible news, but it had to wait until a soft-footed alien servant finished setting up the tea service and pastries, bowed, and withdrew. Neither she nor Ernesto moved to avail themselves of the refreshments. She finally said, "Ernesto, you asked for this meeting which is delaying my return to Oranos, and I have another damn military campaign to plan, so this had better be important." A rebellious noble had led a mutiny among her troops, stolen large number of starships, and declared their system and associated planets to be the Nephilim Confederacy. Mercedes didn't think much of Baron Jasper Talion's branding strategy. Confederate as the root word was probably not the best choice given the divisive human history surrounding it, but then subtlety had never been Talion's strong suit. Ernesto shook himself out of his reverie, which set the single gold earring glinting against his ebony skin.
"Wouldn't this be a better place to plan the campaign to pacify Nephilim than the capital?"
he asked. "Undoubtedly, but they are bringing my son back to Hissalek, and since I haven't seen him for over 2 years, I am damn well going to be there to meet him. Talion and his little confederacy can wait." "Finish one war, start another," she thought wearily, and then added more as a prayer than a hope. "One more battle, and then I can rest." At Ernesto's expression, she quickly amended, "Or not." "So spill it. I doubt your news will get any sweeter over time," Mercedes said. Ernesto touched the controls activating full security measures on the office. Dread crept down her spine and took up residence in the pit of Mercedes' stomach. He exhaled and said,
"The Necrophagos were a Potemkin people."
Dread turned into confusion. "I beg your pardon?" Potemkin sounded vaguely familiar, but Mercedes couldn't place it, and what the hell it had to do with their recently defeated enemies she could not fathom. She raised a questioning eyebrow.
"Prince Grigory Alexandrovich Potemkin Tverchesky, a courtier in the court of Catherine the Great of Russia, famous for..."
"Yes, yes, now I remember. Didn't he build fake villages to fool his queen?"
"Exactly,"
Ernesto said. "And this is relevant how?" Mercedes asked. Chapman Owiti opened up several hollow windows on his tap pad and arranged them in the air all around them.
"Since the mass suicide, or maybe die-off, hard to tell which it was, I've had teams crawling through every aspect of the Necrophagos worlds and culture. My doubts and concerns began with the language. Remember how I told you it more resembled Esperanto or some other created language than a real one?
Yes, so?
Well, it goes deeper than that. We've been studying their religions, all two of them.
Again, I should care why?
No planetary culture has only two religions. Even us with a state religion still have Muslims, Buddhists, Jews, Hindus, Sikhs, Wiccans, and so forth. And within those religions, there are branches and variants. Mormons, Presbyterians, Sunni, Shia, even the Bems have a plethora of pagan creeds.
I don't need a lesson in comparative religion, Ernesto, Mercedes said sharply. Get to the point.
Forgive me, Highness, the curse of suffering from OCD.
The smile briefly flickered on his lips, but it never reached his eyes.
What I'm saying is that this is so unbelievable as to be impossible. Then there is the history and archaeology, or lack thereof. Cultures and societies are messy things. They develop in fits and starts, dark ages, followed by a renaissance. The necrophagos history indicates a triumphant march from primitivism to space. It's simply not credible.
So what are you saying? And don't talk to me about ancient Russia again, Mercedes warned.
I think the necrophagos were created and thrown against us, and whoever did it wasn't trying all that hard to hide their tracks.
He fell silent, and they measured gazes across the table. What neither of them wanted to say hung between them like the rumble of distant thunder. Mercedes shivered, gripped by that sense of something hiding in the shadows, unseen, but still threatening. They're gone. They've been gone for decades, Mercedes said softly.
Gone doesn't mean dead, ma'am. The Karaot were master geneticists.
Ernesto, by naming them, turned her inchoate fear into grim reality.
They could have been using those missing years to grow these creatures and then launch a war against us.
Mercedes surged out of her chair and began to pace. But why? For what possible purpose? Ernesto gave a bedeviled headshake.
Damned if I know. Remember what Westfield used to say in our xenobiology class? They're fucking aliens, who knows why they do anything? And the Karaot were the most alien of all the civilized species.
Not very civilized if they did create a race specifically designed to kill humans, Mercedes countered.
The necrophagos killed a lot of Asanjo, Hajin, Sidon, and flutes, too,
Ernesto reminded her. And if they wanted to destroy us, why not fight us themselves? They almost beat us 3 centuries ago.
Maybe that defeat made them decide that using proxies was a better choice. Why not use others as cannon fodder? The Egyptians and Romans had their auxiliaries.
Didn't work out all that well for the Romans, Mercedes said. Resting her hands on the table, Mercedes leaned in on him. Ernesto, think about what you are suggesting. It would mean that the Karaot have the resources to engineer an entire race, make sure the necrophagos had the resources to launch a massive space fleet,
and then throw the tool away once it had served its purpose,
he concluded quietly. Which was? The import of what he was suggesting penetrated. What?
I'm not sure the mass death of the necrophagos was a choice on their part.
Ice seemed to edge down her spine as she absorbed the full horror of what he was saying. That would be monstrous.
I know. And right now all of this is mere speculation based on a knowledge of history and a mass die-off I can't explain.
What do you want me to do? Mercedes asked.
Right now, nothing. We don't want to go public or even talk to Parliament about my inchoate fears. At least not yet. And you've got a rebellion to suppress. I just wanted you to be aware of my suspicions, misgivings, the thing that's giving me night terrors. And I may be completely wrong, and this is just paranoid fantasy on my part.
They stared at each other for a long moment, Mercedes hoping such was the case. Unfortunately, she didn't think it was. Jahan Bet Ahara stood braced in front of her former captain, and perhaps soon-to-be former friend, blocking his way to the corridor that led off from the galley aboard the small trading starship.
Her arms were akimbo, fists on hips, tail twitching, and she could feel her fur trying to stand up along the length of her spine.
Several decks below, a military shuttlecraft waited to carry Thracius Random Belmanor, Admiral of the Green, back to his frigate. What had precipitated the standoff was her determination that a certain little boy would not be aboard that shuttle when it left. A certain little boy who just happened to be the son of the Empress and heir to the Solar League. The problem was that Prince Cyprian Marcus Sinclair Amadeo de Arango hadn't been sired by the royal consort. Instead, the man who stood bristling with fury in front of her was Cyprian's father, and he'd just found out he had a son. It was an unfortunate fact that information like that tended to do odd things to male brains.
"You all lied to me,"
Tracy said, and his face twisted into a snarl.
"I didn't fucking lie to you. I didn't know about this until I laid eyes on the kid when we picked him up to take him to Freehold. Go yell at Dalia if you want to yell at somebody." "Oh, believe me, she's next on my list, after I take my son."
She had ordered the human boy, Hayden Mackenzie, to take the younger human child out of the galley and back to her cabin.
"You are not keeping that child from his mother," she said,
and she realized she was bearing her rather vicious incisors.
"Did I ever say I was? But that child is mine and I have rights,"
the human yelled. By League standards, he was quite fair-skinned, so she could see the angry color surging in his cheeks, and the gray eyes looked like flint. Jahan gave a mental sigh. Males, no matter their species, were a royal pain in the rear end.
"Yeah, he is. But your rights are just a tad limited in this situation, given how his mom is the Empress of the fucking Solar League, which is why you can't take him on your ship. Anyone with eyes and half a brain will see the resemblance."
"Good."
"Not good. Can you imagine what it'll do to the government?"
Jahan gestured wildly.
"We've got thousands of people homeless and desperate after the war. The economy's in shambles. There's a fucking civil war brewing. You create a scandal and it could bring down the government."
"I don't care,"
he gritted.
"Bullshit. You've always been a goddamn altar boy. You were still using the O-Trail toast despite having been dishonorably discharged. When the military came calling, wanting to reinstate you, you immediately saluted and reported for duty. And finally, what do you think the consort will do to Mercedes if he figures this out?"
That got through to him. However angry and hurt he might be, his love for Mercedes had endured for decades. Jahan pushed her advantage.
"Tracy," she said gently,
"Cyprian is 5 years old. He's been away from his mama for almost 2 years, been kidnapped, watched his nanny get killed in front of him, nearly died escaping, and he's going to need a fucking lifetime of therapy to deal with all this. Right now, he does not need to be confused about who his daddy actually is."
She paused and gathered the human's hands in her own.
"Please, think about that little boy. He needs his mama and the only man he's ever known is his father."
A look of bitter grief swept across Tracy's face. He spun away and began to pace.
"How much more do I have to endure, to sacrifice for crown and empire? I gave her up 6 years ago for the sake of the League, never knowing... Shit, I should have killed Cullen when I had the chance."
"'Cause that always makes things better," Jahan snapped.
Shoulders slumping, he reached out a hand to support himself against the bulkhead. Jahan hurried to his side, slipped an arm around his waist, and gave him a hug. His arm dropped across her shoulders, and he hugged her back. The kind of deep breath that marked a man preparing to face battle and inevitable loss shook his frame. He looked down at Jahan.
"Okay, I'll leave him with you and leave Cipriana aboard as well. But we'll be your escort back to the capital."
"Really, you don't have to. We'll be fine."
"They got off a message before I blew them to hell. If I know Talion, and I do, he'll be looking for payback."
"Oh, Christ on a crutch, you humans. Okay, but please just get us into orbit at Uranos and then go back to your fleet."
"You can't ask that of me. I need to see her, hear directly from her why. Also, I and my crew deserve some of the credit for rescuing the boy."
He gave a sharp, bitter laugh.
"Who knows? Maybe this time I'll finally get a title."
She gazed up at him, trying to fathom this complicated man. In all the years she had known him, he had displayed a deep contempt for the FFH, yet he still desperately craved a title of nobility. He cleared his throat.
"May I see him once more before I go?"
The naked longing in the gray eyes almost broke her resolve. This was a man who craved family so deeply he had built one within the hull of this ship that he had once commanded. It had been a strange and awkward family that had included more aliens than humans. But then wasn't every family strange and awkward in their own unique ways? "Of course, Hayden was taking him to bed. Why don't you go tell him good night?" He didn't reply, just nodded and headed down the corridor toward the cabins. Cipriana's son looked up as the cabin door slid open. He was sitting on the gimbaled bunk, stroking Cyprian's dark amber hair. The little boy was crying softly. Memory draped in grief took Tracy. It was in this room and on that narrow bunk he and Mercedes had first made love. Perhaps their son had even been conceived there. "Hey, Cipri, look. Here is an admiral come to pay his respects. You don't want him to see you crying, do you?" Hayden said. A barely audible, "No," emerged from where the child's face was buried in a pillow. Hayden rose. He had the same almost boneless grace of his mother and gave Tracy a nod. He then slipped out of the cabin. Tracy, taking his cue from the teenager, stepped up to the bunk and gave Cyprian a smart salute.
"Your Highness," he said.
Cyprian might have been only 5, but he knew his duty. He scrubbed at his tear-stained face and left a swipe of snot on his sleeve. Tracy hid a smile. Cyprian looked up at him and inclined his head.
"Thank you," he said.
"Hades says you blew up the bad men."
"I did, sir."
Tracy indicated the edge of the bunk.
"May I sit down?"
"Uh-huh."
Then realizing that probably wasn't proper, he added with odd dignity,
"You may."
"I know your mother very well."
The veneer of royal protocol was swept away.
"You do? Is she coming? Will she come soon? Where is she?"
"She fought a great battle and won, and now she's coming home. We're going to take you to her."
Tracy stiffened as Cyprian threw himself into his arms, then folded the child in an embrace. If a dwarf star had taken up residence in his chest, Tracy couldn't have felt more pressure as he held his son for the first time.
"Won't be the last. I swear it can't be the last time,"
he murmured softly into the boy's curls. A plump hand wound into the lapel of Tracy's jacket.
"I was scared," Cyprian whispered. "Are you ever scared?"
"Lots of times. It's okay to be scared. Sometimes things are just scary."
"Lizzie fell down. There was red all over her chest."
He raised his eyes to meet Tracy's.
"Is she dead?"
He had no experience with children, but Tracy had a sense that lying to them wasn't the best option, especially not to a child who would lead an empire.
"Yes,"
Tracy said softly. Cyprian gave a little hiccuping sob.
"But she's in heaven with El Santo Padre and all the angels,"
Tracy added.
"Will you hear my night-night prayers?"
the little boy sniffed.
"Of course."
Cyprian slipped out of his arms and knelt at the side of the bunk. Tracy knelt beside him. Cyprian folded his hands and closed his eyes.
"Querido Dios, please bless Mama and Papa and Haiti and Snowball," that's my cat, he explained. "And Bouncy,"
another aside, that's my pony,
"and..."
The child broke off and looked up at Tracy.
"I should pray for you too. What's your name?"
"My friends call me Tracy, and I hope we'll be friends, Highness."
"We will. You killed the bad men."
The golden eyes were once more lifted toward heaven.
"And Dios bendiga Tracy too."
Cyprian stood up. Tracy thought the boy tall for his age. "Thank God he has his mother's beauty," he thought, "and doesn't take after me."
"Hedy said I had to go to bed. I don't wanna."
"Aren't you tired?"
Tracy asked.
"Uh-huh, but when I close my eyes, I see things."
Cyprian's voice caught on another small sob.
"Why don't I sing you a song that my father used to sing for me when I went to bed?"
Tracy suggested.
"Can you sing?"
Cyprian asked. The suspicious look Tracy received had him disguising a chuckle as a cough.
"My niñera before Lizzie said she could sing too, and she was horrible."
"Well, why don't you listen, and you can tell me if I'm horrible or not, and if I am, I'll stop."
"Bueno."
Cyprian scrambled back into the bunk and pulled up the covers. Tracy sat on the edge of the bunk and let the words and lyrics of the song La Nanita Nana come back to him. He hadn't sung in a long time. He wanted to be good for his son. Taking a deep breath, he began.
A la nanita nana, nanita ella, nanita ella. Mi niño tiene sueño, benito sia, bendecia. fuentecita que corre clara y sonora, ruiseñor que en la selva cantando y llora.
Nightingale that in the forest sings and weeps. Haunting words that almost broke Tracy's heart. Cyprian's long eyelashes trembled down his cheeks, a small sigh. He was asleep. Tracy leaned down and softly kissed the child's cheek, then slipped out of the cabin, stood panting in the corridor for a moment before he drove his fist hard into the wall, felt the bones break, welcomed the pain.
2. Stratagems. The air was filled with the rumble of engines on the giant earth movers, their growl periodically punctuated by sharp warning beeps when they reversed. The rubble of what had once been the Imperial Palace on Oranos was being cleared away. Occasionally, as dirt and debris dribbled from the voracious maws of the machines, there would be a sparkle, a flash of color, and a worker would run over to inspect whatever treasure might have been unearthed.
"So what's next, sir? Nephilim?"
Anselmo Moran, yelling over the din, asked his boss. There was no doubt about Beauregard Honorius and Claire Cullen, Knight of the Shells, Shareholder General of the Grand Cartel, Duc de Argento y Pepco, and Royal Consorts, reaction to Anselmo's statement. The prince's glance was both horrified and incredulous.
"Christ, we just finished one war. You want to send me off to another already? Gracias, but no."
Anselmo could understand Boho's reluctance. You could get killed in a war. Like every boy of his social station, Anselmo had been sent to the high ground, the Empire's elite military academy, only to wash out at the end of the first year. There was no shame in it. Most of the FFH youth, forced to attend, failed to pass the prueba, and since Anselmo was the sixth son of a mere caballero, his family didn't lay any guilt on him. No. It had been his decision to pursue journalism that had left his father grumbling about slumming in careers better suited to an intitulado. But the old man wasn't grumbling now. Not after Anselmo's work in the palace press office had led him first to be the consort's personal spokesman and now Boho's chief of staff.
"So the Empress will handle Talion?"
Anselmo asked.
"You don't think she's capable?"
Boho cocked an eyebrow at Anselmo, who immediately backpedaled. Anselmo knew his boss's moods very well. Boho might have spent the nearly 30 years of marriage shagging his way through the wives and daughters of the Fortune 500 with a side dish of pretty commoners thrown in for good measure, but he wouldn't tolerate any questioning of his wife's abilities.
"By no means, La Imperatrice is fully capable,"
Anselmo soothed.
"I'm just looking at the advantage of having you both once more working in concert to bring about a brilliant military victory."
He brought up the latest poll numbers on his pad. "Approval of the royals is at an extraordinary 93% right now, sir." That stopped Boho in his tracks.
"Really? That high?"
"Yes, sir."
An odd, distant expression crossed the consort's still handsome face, and he seemed to be looking through him. Anselmo wondered what scheme was being concocted in that cunning mind. No matter. Whatever it might be, the prince would share it with loyal henchmen soon enough. Whatever thought had gripped Boho was shaken off, and the consort walked toward the excavation crews, hand upraised. Engines went to idle and the workers gathered around him. Within moments, they were laughing, nodding, talking eagerly with Cullen. Anselmo shook his head. The man was a bloody miracle. Now, if only there was a way to infuse even a quarter of her husband's charm into the wife. Even as Boho shook hands and asked the automatic questions about wives, children, relatives in the military, and made the proper responses, all while displaying the appropriate emotional reaction, Boho's mind kept turning back to that stunning 93%. But what it triggered was the image of a girl with long golden brown hair, cocoa skin, and pansy brown eyes. Paloma. Boho believed she had loved him, discovered she was merely spying on him on behalf of the Imperial Intelligence Service. But despite the betrayal, he could not shake the hold she had over him. During the war, he had approached her, and they had begun speaking again. "So what? What are you hoping for?" he asked himself. that this level of popularity might mean the public would tolerate you having a public mistress. And Mercedes? Well, why wouldn't she agree? She had tolerated as many liaisons over the years and hadn't set him aside. Now that she was too old to bear another child, and he had done his duty and provided the League with an heir, would she really care? As long as he and Paloma promised not to have a child, for some reason that hurt, the idea that that beautiful Mariposa would never hold an infant to her breast, and what a child they would produce given their respective good looks. His daydream shuddered to a halt. Paloma would never agree. She thought him feckless, narcissistic, and vain. Well, she was right about the vain. But hadn't the past few years of war and his efforts to protect the League proved his worth? A worker ran up brushing the dirt off a diamond tiara. It was twisted and the heat had darkened some of the gems, but he recognized it. Mercedes had worn it for their wedding. Boho cast his eyes toward the sky and murmured,
all right, Santo Padre, I get it. No need to be quite so obvious.
Sir?
The worker said,
nothing. Thank you so much for finding this. You must have unearthed the royal treasury. Let's hope more of our history can be recovered.
He raked them all with an approving look.
And on behalf of the Empress and myself, thank you all for everything you're doing.
God bless the Prince and our Empress,
the foreman called, and the assembled workers cheered. Boho gave them all a smile and a wave and walked back to Anselmo.
They love you, sir,
the younger man said.
If only it weren't so abstract,
Boho said as he pocketed the tiara.
Would you like me to arrange for some discreet, company, sir?
No.
He smiled at Anselmo's expression.
No, I'm not horny. Well, actually, I'm always horny, but I want...
He searched, but couldn't find the words for what he was feeling.
I expect you're missing your son,
Anselmo said diplomatically. Boho noticed Anselmo didn't include Mercedes in the statement.
That I am.
He clapped Moran on the shoulder.
Where to next? A meeting with the cabinet. Rafe wants to discuss converting the war bonds into treasury bonds.
Sounds riveting,
Boho drawled. The palace wasn't the only building that had been reduced to rubble in the alien attack. The parliament building had also been destroyed. Right now, the government of the Solar League was temporarily housed in various office buildings that had survived the attack. Many were damaged, but they could at least keep out the weather. Mercedes had barely returned to the capital, only to be immediately summoned to meet with the Prime Minister. They now sat in his office, a corner suite with windows for walls. One section of glass had a spiderweb of small cracks occluding the view, but through the other, Mercedes could see the silhouettes of enormous cranes like metal monsters scratching at the sky. She hoped that Kronos and Paradise Lost, Yggdrasil and Nueva Terra were equally rich with construction equipment and not just the capital world. Another thing she had to check on, probably in person. But not until Cypri was back and in her arms. The Prime Minister himself filled and overflowed the leather chair behind the desk. Rohan Danilo Marcus Aubrey, Conde de Vargas, was well into his 80s now, and the red in the sparse wisps of hair that covered his skull had been completely replaced with white. While the hair might have retreated, his paunch had grown into a massive swollen belly, and his eyes peered out from pouches of flesh. Still, her godfather's smile was warm and familiar.
You look tired, my dear.
I am, but no time to rest. Once Cypri is home, I have to get back to Hellfire and set in motion plans for subduing Talion and his breakaway planets.
Is that the best use of your time and our resources?
Rohan asked. That made her sit up. I beg your pardon? You want me to allow a member of the FFH to just flout the authority of the Crown and set himself up as a tin-pot dictator?
I'm just thinking that the war against the Necrophagos took a toll on our armed forces and our worlds. Better, perhaps, to recuperate, rebuild our forces before plunging into another fight.
If I do that, what's to stop some royal governor on Balan or Quandru or Yggdrasil who decides to do the same? She shook her head. No, I have to make an example of him.
As you think best, Highness,
he murmured and inclined his head, but she sensed the argument wasn't finished. And right on cue, he said,
Perhaps it is possible to have both.
Go on.
Try diplomacy first. See if a compromise can be reached. Talion's no doubt thinking that as an independent confederacy, he can sell the lithium from Nephilim at an elevated price back to the League. This may be nothing more than economics. He also probably wants to keep these new worlds they discovered exclusively for his population, so there might be room to put limits on the number of settlers from other League planets that could also sweeten the deal.
He abandoned us in the middle of the final and most desperate battle of the war. I'm not inclined to be diplomatic or sweet.
I understand, Majesty. But while the parties would be talking, we could be rebuilding our fleets and replacing the lost troops.
The old man's expression reminded Mercedes forcefully of when one of her cats was caught stealing food from her plate.
And he'll be doing the same, Mercedes objected.
But he's starting at a disadvantage,
Rohan continued.
Nephilim doesn't have a shipyard, and these newly discovered planets certainly don't. Those will have to be constructed, again buying us time.
So you're suggesting I negotiate in bad faith, Mercedes said.
Rohan gave a moo, but didn't actually demur.
Wasn't it Clausewitz who said peace is that state which exists before nations know who they want to invade or the time during which they are preparing to do so?
He also said war is the continuation of diplomacy by other means, Mercedes countered, and I fear that is where, sooner or later, we will ultimately end up.
But later would be better, Highness.
Mercedes gripped the arms of her chair and pushed to her feet.
All right, I'll have Jacon draft a proposal, and yes, I'll have you weigh in on it, Senor Prime Minister, sir.
She gave him a mock salute.
Tracy had called for the senior officers to assemble in the frigate's conference room. Some he knew he could trust. Luis, who had served with him aboard the trading vessel. The young Lieutenant Flintoff, who was a foster child from a hidden world. The others he couldn't be sure of, hence the need for this meeting. To stress the seriousness, he had dispensed with having Batbems provide refreshments. That was one of the cues among the FFH that he had learned in this stratified society. No treats meant serious business. Right now, Tracy was waiting in the corridor some distance from the conference room. His Hajin Batbem Calipus emerged from the room and joined him. The alien turned that long, bony head so he could give Tracy a sideways eye. His white mane set a contrast against the blue of his jacket.
They're all assembled and ready for you, sir.
Tracy checked the chronometer set into the sleeve of his coat.
Let's give it another minute or two. You really do want them sweating,
the alien said. Tracy didn't answer. He waited, counting down the seconds, then walked down the ship's corridor to the door of the conference room. Every pair of eyes focused on him as he strode in, noting his dress uniform and the Distinguido Servicio Cruzar, one of the highest military honors that could be bestowed, glittering on the left breast of his jacket. Like the lack of refreshments, those too sent a message. There was a rustle as the assembled officers came to their feet, braced, and saluted. He reached the head of the table, returned the salute, then said,
"Be seated."
Silence held the room. Tracy waited until their anxiety was like an over-tightened piano wire, then he said,
"The treaty our Empress negotiated with the Hidden Worlds was that no League military vessel would ever enter a solar system held by a Hidden World. In exchange, those planets agreed to house our children and keep them safe from the war, as long as they were brought only by trusted civilian vessels. We have obviously violated that agreement. Emissaries have explained to the government of this particular world the reason for this intrusion, and our explanation has been accepted. However..."
He paused and raked them all with a cold glance.
"I must have your solemn word that you will never reveal the location of this particular planet."
"Sir, it is the established policy of the League that hidden worlds are to be reported and assimilated."
It was Acevedo, the weapons officer, who voiced the first objection.
"I would argue that a recently negotiated treaty between our sovereign lord would take precedence over that particular policy,"
Tracy countered.
"Wouldn't that be for Parliament to decide?"
It was the commander of the Fusileros.
"We're not under the command of the Parliament. We swear an oath to the crown,"
Tracy shot back.
"One could argue that means the government as a whole," said another officer.
Tracy clung to his rapidly vanishing patience.
"The Empress is the supreme commander of all military forces. In this matter, I think we defer to her. and she agreed to this arrangement.
He rested his palms on the table and leaned forward.
And a number of these worlds still have our children. They find out we betrayed one of their fellows, and I'd say they have some very powerful leverage to use against us. So what say we not be the ship and crew that fucks this up?
That penetrated. It was a military truism that nobody wanted to be first. Far better to see the way the wind was blowing and then be the first to be second. One by one, they gave their word of honor. 10 days in fold. 10 days during which they would have no communication with the people and planets inhabiting normal space, nor with the warship that she had to presume was somewhere nearby in this not-space place through which they were currently traveling. After which, they would pop back into reality, and Jahan would have the 3 days of their transit from the outer solar system to Uranus to warn Mercedes what was coming. She still had the Empress's private contact number. Jahan sighed and smoothed the fur around her eyes. She was just a simple little Asanjo trader, mother and wife. How the hell had she ended up in such rarefied company? Blame Thracius random Belmanor, the chaos maker. That had become the crew's mantra over the years, and it showed no sign of abating. Her tail was stiffly upright. She ran a hand down the length of it and tried to relax. The cup of coffee still steaming in front of her probably hadn't been the best move. It was deep into the ship's night cycle. The Taponi flute, Jax, was in the corner of the galley, standing in his pool of water with his blue-tinged resting lights shining on his fronds. Ernie, as was his wont, was sleeping in the engine room. Jahan had her nephew standing watch on the bridge. It really wasn't necessary to have someone in the command center when they were in fold, but she thought it was good discipline for Kieli. Dalia was asleep in the med bay, and the prince was in the captain's cabin, while Commander Lady Cipriana Mackenzie and her son shared one of the others. There was the click of boot heels on the composite decking, and as if Jahan's thoughts had summoned her, Cipriana entered the galley. Apparently, Jahan wasn't the only person who couldn't sleep. Cipriana Mackenzie was a Janus figure. One side of her face was a mass of twisted burn scars, and she had lost her eye on that side. The artificial eye was a dull gray with a red dot like a burning cinder in the center. There was no hair on the right side of her skull. The left side of her face was unblemished and revealed that the woman had been an incredible beauty, and even now at 50, the elegant bone structure and ebony skin were exquisite. The long braids inset with beads chimed softly as she crossed to the table. "Couldn't sleep either?" the human woman asked. Jahan shook her head. "Trying to prepare myself to call the Empress and tell her that Admiral Belmanor..." Cipriana raised a hand. "Relax. It's clear you're all intimately acquainted. You don't have to feign the appropriate obsequious demeanor with me. But you were saying..." "Just that I need to warn the Empress that Tracy is on his way, that he knows..." "Oh, shit."
"Calm, Missy. It's not like it isn't as obvious as the fur on your face."
"So we put the prince, in a sack and you hustle him off the Selkie and back to his mama while Tracy takes a bow?"
"And you and your crew, you should take a bow too."
"Oh, hell no. Folks like us do better when folks like you don't notice us."
Cipriana shook her head, setting the beads to again chiming. "When I knew Tracy at school and that brief time we served together, he tried so very, very hard to fit in, to ape all of us in the FFH, lose his lower-class accent, learn to fence and dance. What I don't..."
"And it did fuck all to save him," Jahan interrupted. "Your lot cashiered him anyway because apparently he was dumb enough to believe all that bilge about honor and duty."
Cipriana cocked her eyebrow at Jahan. "If it makes you feel any better, I was going to be a character witness for him. I never could believe that Tracy would steal."
"He didn't,"
Jahan said shortly. "But that's all ancient history, and I interrupted you. You were saying..." "That I don't understand what's still driving him. He's had a meteoric rise. He's an admiral. And he's still a simple signor. He knows the worst of us. How entitled and feckless we all are. Why would he care when he has the love and respect of people like you and his soldiers and crews who think he practically hung the moons?"
"Because he's a man in love, and people in love do stupid, crazy shit, even when they know it's crazy and stupid.
If he had a title, he thinks. Well, you know what he thinks.
But that's mad. Even if he was made a duke, he doesn't have the pedigree to ever be considered as a royal consort. Yeah, like I said, love makes you nuts.
Cipriana reached out and nervously spun Jahan's mug.
What I wonder is how they ever...
She broke off and cast a glance over at the Taponi flute. Jahan waved it off. Oh, don't worry about Jax. He's in his fugue state. It takes a klaxon to get his attention.
All right, then. How did they ever get together?
It was a fucking fairy tale rescue with a horror story at the end, Jahan said, and she told the human woman about coming into orbit around a hidden world to find a destroyed fleet and a single survivor, the Empress. About the mass suicide of the planet's residents, Mercedes' emotional devastation, the romantic two-week interlude that followed. And at the end of the day, Tracy gave her up because he does believe in all that bilge about duty and honor, and mostly because he was protecting us. No one would have believed she had stayed with us willingly. We would have all been executed.
And he didn't know?
No, that's why his shorts are in a twist. This has hit him hard.
Cipriana laid a hand over Jahan's six-figured hand. Tell you what, let's talk to Mercedes together, and maybe the three of us can come up with a plan that gives everybody at least a bit of what they want.
Yeah, okay.
You sound dubious.
Because most of our plans have always gone pear-shaped.
3. Love has no place in the halls of power. Each hoofbeat raised a puff of dust as Boho and Mercedes cantered side by side. Mercedes' latest mount was the complete opposite of her beloved Utopia. Vento de Broja was an iridescently white stallion with a whimsical sense of equine humor. Utopia had been jet black and had taken himself far more seriously. Boho's newest horse was a big buckskin with the smoothest gaits of any horse he'd ever owned or ridden. They were alone on the chaparral, apart from the 20-person security detail mounted on horses or in flitters, the drone circling overhead to seek and kill any press drones, and all of them carefully scanning for more lethal dangers. Not that the unblinking eye of the media couldn't be almost as deadly, Boho thought. Boho studied his wife's profile, noted the tension in her jaw, the narrowed eyes shaded by the brim of her helmet. He reached out and laid a hand on the right rein and pulled her stallion to a walk.
"You've been grim ever since you got back from seeing Rohan. What's wrong?" he asked.
She sighed and twisted in the saddle to face him. The sunlight kissed her face, deepening the angles of her cheekbones and intensifying the warmth of her dark skin. "I need you to lead a diplomatic mission to Nephilim."
It was the last thing he had expected, and he clenched his hands on the reins, bringing Don Hador to a sudden halt.
"What? Are you insane? Put me in the hands of that traitor?"
He broke off and calmed his breathing.
"Oh, I see. This is Rohan's doing."
She circled her horse back to him and also stopped. "He's not wrong. Entering into another war when we haven't recovered from the last one is madness."
"And Nephilim never suffered any damage,"
Boho said bitterly.
"Exactly. We need time to recover in case we do have to fight. You can buy us that time."
"By becoming a potential hostage?"
"And that risk is why it has to be you and not me," Mercedes said. She reacted to his expression. "If this is going to seem legitimate, I have to send someone of real stature. Also, you're far better suited for this type of mission than I could ever be. You play politics like a virtuoso. I'm awkward, and it feels like I always say the wrong thing." He could feel his frown deepening, and she added brightly, "And who knows, you might succeed." If her intent was to mollify, it was a spectacular failure. Boho tried to breathe through a growing panic settling into his chest.
"But you don't really expect me to succeed. I'm just chum being thrown into the water to buy us time,"
he snapped. "No." She looked distressed at the accusation. "I want you to honestly try. Humans shouldn't be killing each other. Who knows what other threats might be out there?"
She waved vaguely at the sky. Even in full daylight, the nebulae overhead was faintly visible. "There's something odd going on with the necrophagos.
Ernesto is on it, but we don't know anything for certain yet." She broke off and then added, "And there is also Sector 470 to consider."
It was the boogeyman, a portion of space where ships and the men who crewed them vanished. During the reigns of Mercedes' grandfather and father, it had been used as a convenient place to remove troublesome individuals. Mercedes had used it only once, sending the men with whom Boho had conspired to sell promotions into oblivion so they could never reveal his involvement in the corruption. Since then, it had been studiously avoided.
"Fair enough,"
he acknowledged. "You and Talion always got along. You were in the same fencing society. You recommended him for Admiral of the Gold."
"Blaming me for that?"
"No, it was the right call at the right time. No one could have predicted he would turn against us." She looked thoughtful. "And I suppose by his lights it made sense. His system was unscathed. There was no guarantee we were going to win that final battle against the Necrophagos. By deserting when he did, he preserved a large number of his ships."
"Just his bad luck that we did win,"
Boho grunted. "With more than a little help from the aliens themselves," Mercedes added. "That's what Ernesto is on about. He thinks it's more than just ritual seppuku."
"I sincerely hope he's wrong,"
Boho said. "Amen."
"All right, I'll go. But may I wait until Cypri comes home? I want to see my son."
"Of course. I know he'll want to see you too. I wonder how much he's grown. I've missed so much." Her voice trailed away and he reached over and gripped her hand. Mercedes shook off her mood and returned to business. "The diplomats will have to do their dance, set out all the terms for the meeting. That will take some time. I messaged the captain of the trading vessel that I wanted them to pick up Cyprian and Hayden. I should hear back from her soon." The call came in on her private account. As the hologram stabilized, Mercedes found herself looking at Cypriana, her oldest and closest friend in the world. Mercedes' pleased smile slipped, however, when the little alien, Jahan, thrust her way into the image.
Mercedes was able to make out a bit of the background and realized they were in the galley of the trading ship.
A frown wrinkled her brow. Cypriana was assigned to the flagship Suta Bereza, commanded by Tracy. So why was Cypri aboard the Selkie? Her thoughts were interrupted by Cypriana, apparently reading her mind. "No, I'm not aboard the Suta Bereza. I'm on the Selkie with your son and my son." Mercedes opened her mouth to respond, but Cypriana rushed on. "No, I'm not going to give you the entire backstory right now. Suffice it to say it involves Talion, Nephilim, and all kinds of chicanery, shenanigans, and skullduggery. But that's not our biggest problem."
"It's Tracy, Highness,"
the Asanjo interrupted. "He commandeered a frigate and rowed to the rescue," Cypriana said.
"Which was good, otherwise our sons would be on Nephilim by now."
"What? How? How did Talion find out about Cyprian's whereabouts?" The little alien looked uncomfortable.
"Again, long story. The problem is Tracy. He knows, ma'am," Jahan said.
There was no mystery to the meaning of Mercedes' appalled expression, and the two females, one human and one alien, understood instantly.
"Is Boho on Oranos?"
Cypriana asked. Mercedes could only nod. She couldn't force words past the terror that was closing her throat.
"Don't suppose you can send him away?" Cypriana suggested.
Mercedes cleared her throat and managed to croak out, "How long do I have?"
"We just dropped back into normal space and are 3 days out from Oranos," said Jahan.
"That may give me enough time. He's supposed to head a delegation to Nephilim. I'll just up the timeline."
"We just need to make sure nobody gets a look at Tracy and the prince together," Jahan said.
"How obvious is it?" Mercedes asked. "My 15-year-old son saw it instantly," Cypriana said. Mercedes gave a moan of despair.
"And Tracy intends to see you, ma'am. He is really pissed," Jahan added.
Mercedes' anger flared.
"Well, what did he expect? He's the one who said we couldn't be together."
"Yeah, but he didn't know you were pregnant back then, and you know what he's like when he's angry. Personally, I'd advise you not to see him,"
Jahan said.
"Tell him to get his butt back to his fleet."
She gave a little cough.
"Not that I should be telling you what to do, ma'am, Highness."
"Among our class, it's not such a big thing to have a cuckoo in the family nest. It's just part of the culture of the FFH," Cyprian mused. "Though, to be fair, it's usually not the firstborn."
"Yeah, but Tracy isn't a member of your exclusive club. I doubt he's going to be that open-minded,"
Jahan countered. "Nor will Boho," Mercedes said, "especially given how he feels about Tracy."
You should have planned this better, Mayor, Cipriana complained. Why couldn't you arrange to get knocked up by Davin, God rest his soul, or somebody else in our circle?
Mercedes sat silent for a moment, then said quietly, Because I didn't love him. The look of devastation on her friend's scarred face was ample evidence that Cipriana shared Mercedes' grief, but her words were stripped of any such sentiment. You are who you are, Mare, and love has no place in the halls of power. Anselmo was happily married, but even he felt a tingle of desire as he looked down at Paloma. The girl was breathtakingly beautiful, though the eyes that looked out from the piquant face were older than her years and carried the wisdom and cynicism of a much older soul. The hallway in the orphanage smelled of dirty diapers, baking bread, talcum powder, and the stringent cleaner a mop-wielding Hajin was swapping across the tiled floor. There was the sound of children's laughter and children's tears, and the murmur of women's voices teaching, soothing, playing, and reading to the orphans. The war might be over, but they were going to be dealing with the wreckage for decades to come. "Is there an elegant title for Imperial Pimp?" Paloma asked. "Such ugly words to be delivered in such bell-like tones," Anselmo thought. He felt the heat rising in his cheeks, but he firmly put aside his first impulse, however justified, to snap back. His master usually had his way with any women he wanted, so sooner or later this one would be back in Boho's arms and in his bed, and it wouldn't do to have made an enemy of her. He forced himself to smile.
"I actually prefer palace procurer. Sounds more official. But believe me, the prince has no unworthy intentions toward you. He's going to be undertaking a delicate and dangerous mission, and he wanted to see you."
"Why?" Anselmo decided on candor.
"Truthfully, I have no idea, but it feels less like seduction and more like he just wants to talk to you. That being said, the prince has had a lot of women over the years, but you're the only one he can't forget."
"Am I supposed to be flattered by that? And is his wife in the can't-forget category, too?" she asked with sweet sarcasm.
"Dios, you are tough,"
Anselmo said, and decided that he would rather take a cobra to bed than mess with this girl, no matter how beautiful she might be. Still, his employer was obsessed, and it wasn't going to be Anselmo's dick that was in jeopardy of going through a ringer if this reunion went badly. Right now, his only task was to satisfy his employer's desire and get this girl to accompany him. Anselmo decided to try and appeal to pity.
"Look, I think he's lonely, and frankly, he's scared. I think he fears he won't come back and he wants to try and mend things with you."
She stood very still, a thoughtful expression on her face. "So he's heading to Nephilim," the girl mused. Anselmo stared at her in shock. How she had deduced that from his remarks, he had no idea. He knew Boho and Paloma had had an affair that seemed to have ended badly, so he wasn't entirely sure why his boss was so set on this meeting, but his was not to question why. His was but to do, or, studying Paloma's cold eyes, Anselmo once again found himself thinking about snakes and ringers and felt his balls trying to pull up into his scrotum. Anselmo took a quick look around, leaned in closer, and said softly,
"Yes, but not with troops. At least not yet. The Empress is sending a delegation to try and negotiate a peaceful settlement."
"Interesting. And smart. All right, now I'm intrigued. But make it clear to the consort that this meeting better take place in an office, or preferably a public setting. And if there is a hint of a couch, bed, rollaway, cot, futon, sleeping bag, air mattress, anything, I will walk out."
"I will relay your conditions."
It was the second day Tracy had spent aboard the Selkie, and now as the 5 hours he allowed himself to spend with his son drew toward an end, he tried once again to convince himself not to return tomorrow. But it would be his final opportunity. They would enter Uranus orbit around 7 in the evening Hiselic time. Tomorrow morning he had to contact the Empress's office and request a discreet security detail meet him. He had to arrange for the Selkie to be allowed to land in the area of the Cristobal Colon spaceport reserved for military vessels. He had to demand, a private audience with Mercedes. And if she refused, what then? His hand tightened on one of the plastic Lego blocks he'd had his fabricators aboard the Swiftsure make for Cypri. The corners pressed sharply into Tracy's palms, almost enough to draw blood. Cyprian gave him a frowning look.
I need that one.
Tracy hid a smile at the imperious little voice.
Your pardon, Highness.
He handed over the piece and watched Cyprian, tongue sticking out of the corner of his mouth, fit it into place on the edifice he was constructing. Tracy had nothing to measure against and was also undoubtedly biased, but he thought Cyprian displayed an abundance of intelligence and creativity.
When am I going to see Mommy and Daddy?
Cyprian asked as he rocked back on his heels and critically surveyed his creation.
Tomorrow evening.
Why is it taking so long?
He drew out the vowel on the last word, making it into a petulant whine. Tracy smiled at him.
Because space is big.
That's not an answer.
You're going to get that answer a lot, even when you go off to the high ground.
Do I have to go?
Everyone does. Your mother went, your Prince Cullen went, I went. Don't you want to?
Tracy asked. An almost imperceptible headshake.
War is why Mommy sent me away, why Lizzie is dead. I don't like war.
Tracy slipped an arm around the boy's shoulders and hugged him close.
Neither do I, but sometimes we don't have a choice. Public enough for you?
Boho hoped it didn't sound petulant. He was seated at a rickety table at an ad hoc open-air cafe that had sprung up in the aftermath of the war. Behind the large portable grill, a pair of enterprising chefs were preparing tacos and fajitas. Even in the midst of devastation, humans would always find a way to make a real, he mused. The smell of grilling chicken, beef and vegetables, and the sharp tang of salsa fought for primacy over the dust being kicked up by earth movers clearing debris at the end of the street.
Well done,
Paloma said as she took the chair opposite him. Clever, too. The noise from the machinery will cover our conversation, and your security will keep any eavesdroppers well away while you get to smile and wave. She said, as he was doing just that to a pair of women who stood across the street beaming and simpering at him. And makes the people feel like their government cares.
So cynical for one so young,
Boho said, turning back to her and away from the matrons who went on their giggling way. Paloma merely gave a shrug in response.
So why am I here? Paloma asked.
I'd like you to accompany me to Nephilim,
Boho said. He held up a hand to forestall the objection he saw rising to her lips.
And no, not as my mistress, as part of my staff.
They're still going to assume we're boinking again and that I'm just a bed warmer, Paloma said.
Which is fine. Add to that your youth and beauty and no one will take you seriously. You'll be completely overlooked.
My, you're making this seem so attractive, she drawled. Boho gave a sigh of exasperation.
Point being, you can move about more freely, talk to more people, learn far more than I ever could locked away in meetings. You're a trained Segu agent, but I doubt that Talion or anyone on his staff knows that.
She cocked her head in that bird-like motion that he found so adorable.
Okay, beginning to sound more attractive. When would we leave? She asked.
Well, I thought it would be several weeks, if not months, but Mercedes has pushed up the timeline. She wants me to leave tomorrow.
I could probably pack a few ball gowns by then, Paloma said.
She glanced up at him from beneath her lashes and gave him that enchanting little smile.
All right, I'm in. But I best have my own cabin on the ship, and I've taken to sleeping with a knife under my pillow, if you take my meaning.
Your message has been received, loudly and clearly.
She stood.
By the way, what ship are we taking? Probably wouldn't do to arrive in a dreadnought.
We'll be taking the Imperial pinnace and have a frigate for escort.
Let's hope Talion plays fair, Paloma said.
I've never known him to,
Boho responded. That gave her a moment's pause, but then she smiled.
Well, you certainly know how to show a girl an interesting time.
Sir, do you know why Admiral Belmanor is arriving on Uranos this evening?
Iris Nebiev asked.
He also requested a private audience with the Empress, according to Jakan.
Anselmo waved away the various holographs floating over his desk and peered at his assistant over the top of his glasses. He was bucking tradition in that he had hired a woman and an intitulado for the position. There had been more than a few grumbles from the old guard who felt that a woman's place was in the home, trying to outbreed the aliens, but Anselmo didn't give a rat's ass for their disapproval. Iris was whip-smart and never hesitated to tell Anselmo when she thought he had his head up his ass. To avoid the inevitable gossip and innuendo, Iris was in her mid-50s. She was a large woman, but carried the weight with neither embarrassment nor defiance. She dressed elegantly, but made no effort to disguise her belly or hips. This was a woman who was entirely comfortable with herself.
Now, how would you know that, Iris? A nun in a celibate order is less protective of her virtue than Jacan is with the Empress's calendar.
Because I made friends with his file clerk who keeps his cloud storage in order, gave her some of my new eyeshadow. Anselmo gave her a nod of approval. The company Iris had founded after the death of her intitulado husband was proving to be very useful. It had brought her to Anselmo's attention because his wife wore her products, and Julia had recommended Iris for the job. Iris had been intrigued by the offer, and since she had groomed her eldest daughter to run the company, she had accepted, saying she'd wanted to see how the sausage got made.
"The Green Fleet has returned?"
Anselmo asked, pulling his thoughts back to the moment.
"No, the Orbital Portmaster reports only two arriving ships, a Firelance frigate, the Swiftsure, and a trading vessel, the Selkie. A landing request for the trading vessel and a shuttle from the frigate had been sent to the military side of the spaceport."
The Swiftsure didn't ring any bells, but the Selkie sure as hell did. It was the private vessel that had carried the Crown Prince to safety on a hidden world. And Belmanor rang a fucking alarm bell for Anselmo. Belmanor was the man Anselmo's boss had ordered Anselmo to have killed. Fortunately, Anselmo had managed to talk the consort out of that rash move.
"I don't like this," Anselmo said. "Maybe he's looking to segue into politics now that the war is over and he wants to play up his fame? He was the man who captured that alien ship, gave us our first real victory,"
Iris suggested.
Anselmo shook his head.
"I don't think so. Man is not known for his diplomatic skills. Brash and brilliant is more his reputation. Neither work well in politics."
Anselmo tugged at his upper lip and considered.
"Do we have a manifest of who's aboard? I thought you might want that."
She looked down at her tap pad. "Aboard the Selkie, the crew, mostly aliens, oddly enough, but what's interesting is Commander Lady Mackenzie is aboard along with her son Hayden and an unidentified minor. Aboard the military shuttle is the Admiral and a full security team."
It all snapped into place.
"They're bringing back the Crown Prince. That has to be it. That's why there are MPs aboard the shuttle."
"Do you want me to be down at the spaceport when he lands? I can let you know."
"We've got to do more than that. This is a golden opportunity. We need press. Lots of press. Hero returns, bringing the beloved heir back to the arms of his doting mother."
Anselmo bracketed the final sentence with his hands, picturing the banner headline. His hands dropped like deflating balloons.
"Damn shame Boho left earlier today. Wonder why they didn't delay his departure."
"Maybe they didn't know," Iris suggested.
"That doesn't make any sense. You don't just drop in on royalty with a, oh, by the way, I have your son and heir with me."
"Or perhaps the Empress wanted a private reunion with her son."
"That leaves out her husband and the boy's father? That doesn't make any sense." "Damn the woman. Understand I say that with respect. But I wish she could grasp the importance of controlling the news cycle. This kind of moment, heroic mother, warrior, and ruler greets her only child, could push that approval number to a level never before seen. It's publicity gold. Would be fucking platinum if Boho were here too."
"Anselmo, not everything needs to be a moment to drive the narrative. Sometimes you have to let people just be normal people, even royal people,"
Iris said. Anselmo stood, came around the desk, and dropped an arm over her shoulders.
"First, they're not normal people. And sometimes, Iris, we know better than our employers what's in their best interests."
4. What a fine mess. They had to wait for the heat of the landing to dissipate before they could open the bay door and lower the ramp. The entire crew had gathered to say farewell to their unexpected guests. The time Jahan had spent with Cipriana gave her an appreciation of the woman's brains and grit. And of course, they all adored Hayden. The little prince was trying to be proper, but he was alternating between excitement and tears as the reunion with his parents drew near. Hayden was brushing shoulders with Kieli. The pair had grown close during the time Hayden had been a crew member, and now it was coming to an end. It was
unlike. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.